Well, good morning. Turn with me in your Bibles, if you would, to Luke 24. I want to just welcome everybody to have a happy Easter, and I'm glad you're all here to worship with us today. This is the time we take to take communion and remember Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. And today we really want to emphasize the resurrection because that's what we celebrate on Easter. I know for me, as when I was a kid growing up going to the church, I'd sit in church service and rarely pay attention. But for some reason on Easter, the story of Easter really got my attention. Not because I really understood it. I don't know if they didn't explain the why of what was going on with Jesus dying on the cross and being raised from the dead and all of that. But I certainly didn't get the why. And I remember always feeling so angry that I felt angry at God that he allowed Jesus to die. I just thought, why? Somebody could have stopped this. You know, I just had all those different feelings, and I didn't really understand what was going on. I was comforted later in life as I started really seriously reading the Bible to discover that Jesus' friends, closest friends, the disciples, didn't get it either. And we're going to start reading about that in Luke chapter 24. This is after Jesus has been raised from the dead. We'll start reading in verse 13. It says, "Now that same day, two of them who were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, they were talking with each other about everything that had happened. And as they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, 'What are you discussing together as you're walking?' They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Clopas, asked him, 'Are you the only visitor? Are you only a visitor to Jerusalem and do not know the things that have happened in these days? "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and the elders handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but they didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who had said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. He said to them, 'How foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets had spoken. Did not the Christ have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?' And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning him." You know, there's story after story you can really look and see. The disciples were completely confused. I mean, they were baffled when Jesus was arrested. They were scattered during his trial, and very few of them even really stood nearby as he was crucified. They were disappointed that Jesus didn't do what they thought he was going to do. Maybe he wasn't who they thought he really was, and confusion reigned. They didn't get what Jesus was really about and what he was really doing. You know, I've been thinking a lot lately about the 3 days from the crucifixion through the resurrection. There were some radical things that happened, things that have really changed the world. And there are people in there that were, this is an incredible game changer for many people's lives. You think about, besides the disciples being confused, think about Pontius Pilate and what the resurrection, what he might have thought. We don't really have anything that says what it is. But here's a guy who believed that he quelled a rebellion and saved his job when Jesus was killed. I wonder what he was thinking when he found out that he was raised from the dead. I wonder what Herod thought. Here's a guy who, starting with his father and through him, I mean, his father tried to kill Jesus as a little boy. And when Jesus was crucified, he thought, "My kingdom has been saved." I wonder what he thought when he found out the tomb was empty. I wonder what Caiaphas thought, the high priest. He believed when Jesus was crucified that he and his role in it, he had saved the temple. And that he had saved the Jewish race because he had saved combat, basically, and saved peace with the Romans. I wonder what he thought about when he found out the tomb was empty. You see, the resurrection is such a central piece to Jesus' story and to Christianity. It is the power. It is the proof that God gives us the power to have changed lives. You think about the place of the story in Acts chapter 1 when the disciples gathered together and they cast lots to pick a replacement for Judas who had been killed. They said, we're picking somebody who will be a witness with us or join us as a witness to the resurrection. It was going to be a key part of their story. Acts chapter 4, and Peter and John were arrested. They were arrested in the temple for preaching the resurrection. And later on in verse 33 of that chapter, they said, they continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. You see, the resurrection is all about God's power that's available in our lives. And I think that when you really look at the disciples and how they scattered and they ran and they were afraid when Jesus was arrested, and then they were transformed to people who were arrested themselves, people who were beaten in the name of Jesus, and ultimately, with the exception of John, were killed for their faith. It was the resurrection that transformed them. What about us? As we celebrate Easter today, you know, we get together and the world gets together and they dress up and they put on their hats and they go, you know, we have Easter dinner and we come to church. For many people, it may be the only day they come to church. And I'm grateful that they do. But is the resurrection more than just a good ending to a story that might have been a little bit sad? Or is it more? I think even for us, as we sit here and we come to church and we read our Bibles, have we grown numb to really the power of the resurrection in our lives? In Romans chapter 6, it talks about when we're baptized, we're buried with him through faith, that we make contact with the blood of Jesus at that time, and that we're just as he was raised from the dead, we too are raised in our baptism to live a new life because of the power of the resurrection. You know, I look at my own life and I think, do I live a life on a daily basis that reflects the power of the resurrection? See, because if we understand the power of the resurrection, the grace of God will teach us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions. We won't conform to the people around us. We'll be different. And they'll know, they won't know, oh, you're different because you go to church a lot. They'll notice that you're different because of who you are. That difference, some people will be drawn to it because you have something you need. Some people will reject it and be angry, just like in the Bible. But I really want to challenge us as we take the bread that represents that broken body, as we drink the juice that represents that blood that cleanses us from our sin, to be changed by the resurrection and to live resurrected lives. Let's bow and pray. Father, thank you so much, God, that you've given us something that is beyond measure in the resurrection of Jesus. God, thank you that you rescued him from the grave. Father, thank you that you demonstrated that you are powerful over sin while we're powerless. And God, I pray that we can really deeply understand within our hearts that we'll recognize that power that's available to us. Father, that you didn't just raise us out of the waters of baptism to be religious people, but Father, to be transformed the way the disciples were, to go from being cowards and selfish people, Father, to being selfless people who were full of courage and that were... God, that we're willing to proclaim your gospel boldly the way the disciples did. Father, that we're willing to say no to the ungodliness of this world. Father, to the lies, to the impurity, to the greed, and to all the idols in our lives, and say no to them because of the grace that came with Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. And the proof, God, that you will raise us in the end just as you raised Jesus. Father, help us to reflect that on that. God, help us to deeply understand it. And God, help us to decide to live resurrected lives today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Happy Easter. Hope you guys are all excited about being able to be at church this morning and the opportunity to focus on the resurrection. Because today is a day of victory. It's a day of celebration. Because the tomb is empty. Jesus rose from the dead. That's why we're here. That's the only reason that we can be here, is because of the resurrection. And this morning, the title of the lesson is The Resurrection Changes Everything. You know, and if we really believe, not just intellectually accept, but really believe that the resurrection is true, that Jesus really rose from the dead, that has the potential to change everything about our lives and about who we are. Randall, if you can go to the third slide, and then we'll come back to the second. Revelation chapter 1, verse 17 says, "When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. Then he placed his right hand on me and said, 'Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead, and behold, I am alive forever and ever. And I hold the keys of death and Hades.'" That's Jesus speaking. I think we just need to take a moment to appreciate the power that this verse communicates to all of us today. I was dead, but behold, I'm alive forever and ever. That's the Jesus that we serve. That's the God that we serve. And Easter is an incredibly powerful time to remember that, to proclaim that, to accept it and to believe that in our lives. And if we do, it'll change everything for us. You know, he says, don't be afraid. And I know for each one of us, I know for me anyway, that for each one of us, when it says, don't be afraid, there's something that comes to your mind immediately. Immediately. Circumstance that you're facing, something that you're battling with, something that you're dealing with, something going on in your family, maybe it's your marriage, your children, something at work, finances, whatever. He said, don't be afraid. There's something that comes to our minds. There's something that grips our hearts. But Jesus says, don't be afraid. Not because you're so awesome, not because of the power of positive thinking, but because I was dead and I'm alive. Randall, you can play the video.
There's a peace I've come to know. Though my heart and flesh may fail, there's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. Darkness breaks to light, and the shadows disappear, and my faith shall be my eyes. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. My name, no more sorrow.
God in heaven, thank you so much that we have the opportunity now to study your word. God, that we have the opportunity to look at the scriptures and really look at what it says about Jesus raising from the dead. And God, that the power that gives us, even as Will referenced in the scripture that he read this morning in the welcome, God, about the power that raised Jesus from the dead is available to us. And God, we're just so grateful that the story didn't end at the cross, that the rest of the story was that Jesus rose from the dead. And God, as we study that this morning, help us to embrace that message that you've given to us so that we can walk out changed. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Randall, you can go to the fourth slide. I wanted to just start off by looking at a few scriptures, a few references to the resurrection. And in Matthew 28, if you can turn with me there, verses 5 through 7. It says, "The angel said to the women, 'Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus, who is crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he is risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you.'" Turn over to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We're not going to look at all these here. If you want to write those down, you study them on your own or look at them on your own. But in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, starting in verse 3, it says, "For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures, and that he appeared to Peter and then to the 12, and then he appeared to many others after that." You know, as I was studying various scriptures this week and leading up to today, just because of, you know, the focus that we give this time of year to Easter and to the resurrection, you know, Matthew 28, I love that verse, because when they went to the tomb and they were looking for Jesus, the angel said to them, "He's not here. He's risen." In another account in Luke, it says, "Why are you looking for the living among the dead? He's not here. He is risen." And I think in that statement, there's incredible power for us today. If we believe that, if we accept that. And today, the tomb is still empty. If we went to Jesus' tomb, if we knew where that was, it would still be empty. He didn't go back. He's risen. He's alive. 1 Corinthians 15, Paul says, "As of first importance, I pass on to you." And he talks about how Jesus died for our sins according to the scriptures. But he didn't stop there, did he? That wasn't the story. That wasn't the entire message. But sometimes we stop right there. And that's an important thing. I'm not taking anything away from what Jesus did on the cross, because it's through that broken body and that sacrifice that God's grace comes to us. But if that's where it stops, if you read later on in 1 Corinthians, we're fools. We have no hope if the story stops there. But Paul says, but that he was raised according to the scriptures. God's will was that not only that he would die, but that he would raise. So if we believe that the resurrection happened, it changes everything. It changes our view of Jesus. It changes how we live. And it changes where we're going. I want to ask you this morning, when I say Jesus, what picture comes to your mind? You go to the next slide, Randall. Is that your picture of Jesus? Now, there's nothing wrong with that picture. But oftentimes, that's the Jesus we envision. The Jesus with the lambs and the little children. And Jesus loved lambs and little children. And that's great. You can go to the next picture, Randall. Maybe that's your picture of Jesus. Maybe a little bit more accurate. I don't know. They're both just pictures of Jesus. We don't know what he really looked like. But I want to ask you this morning, what is your picture of Jesus? Is your Jesus the Jesus that rose from the dead? Is he the one that holds the power and of death and Hades, the keys, in his hand? Because if we have a weak picture of Jesus, then we're going to be weak followers of Jesus. But if we have a powerful picture of Jesus, then we can follow a powerful Savior who will lead us and provide for us. And when he says, don't be afraid, we don't have to be afraid. Because we know he's going to lead us. And he's going to lead us powerfully to where God wants us to be. You can go to the next slide, Randall. You know, the resurrection changes our view of Jesus. If we and we're not going to go through all these scriptures through Matthew, but I want to just highlight a few of them. In Matthew chapter 4, as Jesus was beginning his ministry, he went out into the desert. He fasted for 40 days. And it says, in verse 1, then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the desert to be tempted by the devil. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, if you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread. And he goes on and he tempts him in different ways. I don't know I don't know if any of you have. I know we all have fasted. And fasting is not fun. And fasting makes you, he fasted for 40 days. I don't know, the longest I've ever fasted, like abstain completely from food, is like 7 days. And that was miserable. And I was weak, and I was not, my mind was loopy, and it was difficult. And it says that Jesus fasted for 40 days. So take my meager 7 days and expand that out for 40 days. And here's Jesus. And at his weakest physically, maybe mentally, maybe emotionally, at his weakest is when Satan comes and tempts him. And if you jump down to verse 10, it says, Jesus said to him, away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. Then the devil left him. That's a powerful Jesus. At his weakest, he told Satan to leave him alone, and Satan left. He had no power over him. So if we follow Jesus, if we see Jesus that way in our own lives, it changes everything for us. We don't have to give in to Satan's temptations and his attacks. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 24, Jesus is going through the Sermon on the Mount, and he tells the rich people that he was speaking to. He says, you can't serve both God and money. You got to choose. There's only one God. There's only one person to follow. And if we really understand the resurrection, we understand who Jesus is, that he rose from the dead, then making that decision between money and Jesus, no decision. Easy. But sometimes, and I know we all struggle with it, I do. We struggle with whether it's money or different things. I mean, we're weak. We're not Jesus. But if we see him as he really is through the resurrection, it changes things for us. And it helps us to make those decisions and to realize that this money, these things, these possessions, these accumulations of things, they're not worth it. Matthew chapter 8, says that as Jesus was, he was taking his disciples, and they were getting ready to go through to the Gadarenes, and there were two demon-possessed men, and that those, says that nobody, these guys were so violent that nobody could pass through there. And I went through, and I decided not to do it. I went through, and I searched some images for, like, violent men and different things, and there were some scary-looking people, you know, and I looked up demon-possessed men, and because I wanted to put some pictures up there for us to have something mentally to look at, and I was like, nah, it's probably not a good idea. Nothing inappropriate, but just maybe not a place for church. But it says that they were going through there, and Jesus, he just went right on through. And these guys came up to Jesus, and they said, Son of God, have mercy on us. Don't torture us. So here are two incredibly powerful guys. Violent men that hurt people, that didn't allow anybody to pass through. And here goes Jesus. Undeterred. And they said to him, the demons within them said, are you going to torture us before the appointed time? They understood, and scriptures even talk about how at the name of Jesus, demons shudder. They had the right view of Jesus. They see Jesus for who he is. And through the resurrection, through Revelation chapter 1, like we read earlier, Jesus says, I was dead, I'm alive. We can have that same view of Jesus, and we can let him lead us through those challenging circumstances. Maybe it gives a different view of Psalm 23 of, when the Lord is my shepherd, he'll lead me through the valley of the shadow of death, and I'll fear no evil. That's the Jesus that leads us. Matthew chapter 10, verse 37 through 39, Jesus is calling people to follow him, to be disciples of his. And he says, if you don't love your father, your mother, your wife, your children, you're not worthy of me. Well, Jesus, that's pretty harsh. That's not very nice, Jesus. That's not a good way to get people to follow you, Jesus. But Jesus knew who he was. Not in arrogance, but he knew who he was. And he's not going to be on anybody's equal ground. I'm up here. That's how you need to see me. I'm not just one amongst many relationships. I'm the you don't know it yet, but I'm the resurrected Jesus. And if you don't see me that way, and you don't love me that way, you're not worthy of me. Jesus is powerful, and he wants us to see him that way so that we follow him that way. Because that's what he wants to lead us to God. He wants to lead us to heaven. He wants to lead us through our fears. But if we don't see him that way, he can't, because we don't let him. Matthew chapter 20, if you can turn with me there. Now, as Jesus was going up to Jerusalem, he took the 12 disciples aside and said to them, we're going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be betrayed to the chief priests and to the teachers of the law. They will condemn him to death and will turn him over to the Gentiles to be mocked and flogged and crucified. On the third day, he will be raised to life. You know, I love this picture of Jesus. He's going up to Jerusalem, and he tells his disciples that this is what's going to happen to me. But it's not happening to me because I have no power or ability to stop it, or authority to keep it from happening, or the ability to call from God to call angels down to stop this whole thing. Quite the opposite. Jesus is saying, I'm going to let them. I'm going to allow them to do these things to me. Why? Because of each one of you and because of me. Because I love you, I'm going to let them do this to me. That's power. When you let somebody, when you have the ability to stop it and you choose not to because of love, That's power. And then he says, and on the third day, I'll be back. I'm gonna be raised to life. And these are just a few scriptures, a few things for us to look at to see Jesus through the light of the resurrection and the powerful, mighty, incredible Lord that he is. That's the God of the Bible. That's the Jesus of the Bible. And that's who he wants us to see. You know, the resurrection can change how we live. Mark chapter 16, verses 67. You can go to the next slide, Randall. Sorry, I'm going to move really quickly. Mark chapter 16, verses 6 through 7. Again, the account of the resurrection. Don't be alarmed, he said. You're looking for Jesus the Nazarene, who was crucified. He is risen. He's not here. See the place where they laid him? But go, tell his disciples and Peter, he's going ahead of you in Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you. Now, I have up here just kind of a little note, spiritual failure. You know, the reason I put that down is because, and it could be, you could put in any kind of failure. We fail. We make mistakes. We're weak people. We like to see ourselves in a different light sometimes. And we fool ourselves, and sometimes we have the ability to fool other people. But we make mistakes. Peter made a mistake and a failure that he thought he would never do. Just a few chapters earlier, just a short time earlier, when they were having the Lord's Supper, Jesus told them, you guys are all going to leave me and betray me. Peter said, I'll never do that. Have you ever made that statement in your life before? I have. Many times. I'll never do that. I'll never do it again. I'll never do that again. And again, and again. But here, Jesus made sure. He said, go tell the disciples and Peter. Go tell the disciples and Donnie. Go tell the disciples and fill in the blank with your name. Because you know what that communicates? Hey, Peter, it's okay. I rose from the dead. I overcame. My power is bigger than your mistakes. My power is bigger than your failures. And whether we've been following God or trying to follow God and we've made mistakes, we're facing challenges with our families, marriage, children, jobs, finances, whatever it is. Things that we thought, I wouldn't do that. On the other side of the resurrection, Jesus said, go tell them that I'm alive and I'm going ahead of them. John chapter 11, verses 33 through 44. It's the story of Jesus raising Mary and Martha's brother Lazarus from the grave. Lazarus had died. He was in the grave for 4 days. It's a big problem. Do you think your problems are big? Jesus, don't do this. He's been in there for 4 days, and you know what? He stinks. He's dead. He's decomposing. It's done. It's a done deal. Circumstances are too great, Jesus. If you'd have been here earlier, maybe things would be different. Jesus said, move the stone. Lazarus, come on out. What'd Lazarus do? He came out. And Jesus makes a powerful statement at the end. He says, take his grave clothes off and put new ones on him. You know, I've had the opportunity to experience resurrection power. And he may not want me to say it, but that's okay. I am inspired by and so proud of my son. Seeing the changes that God has brought about in his life is just inspiring. Having the conversations that we've had and seeing his heart and his desire to serve God and to do great things for God. And seeing the before and the after. And I've always been proud of him. I always loved him. It's nothing to do with it. But just seeing what God has done and the power of what happens when we see Jesus the right way. And how the resurrection can change how we live. And if we're studying the Bible, we're seeking God. God wants us to understand that and know that. And I want to call you out of the grave. I want to take those grave clothes off. I want to put new ones on you. And send us on our way different. You know, the resurrection changes where we're going. Romans chapter 5, Romans chapter 6 talks about how if we've been united with him in his death, we're certainly also going to be united with him in his resurrection. And that because of that, we have the hope of heaven. We have the hope of a new life. It completely changes the direction of where we're going. You know, maybe we're going here, and Jesus says, no, I'm going this way. I want to raise you. I want you to come with me. I want to close by looking at two verses in Revelation. Revelation 20. Starting in verse 4. It says, I saw thrones on which were seated those who had been given authority to judge. And I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded because of their testimony for Jesus and because of the word of God. They had not worshipped the beast or his image and had not received his mark on their foreheads or their hands. They came to life and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. The rest of the dead did not come to life. The rest of the dead did not come to life until the 1,000 years were ended. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and are holy are those who have part in the first resurrection. The second death has no power over them. But they will be priests of God and of Christ and will reign with him for 1,000 years. And there's a lot of symbolism in Revelation, but he's saying, hey, these guys, they didn't give in. They didn't bow down. They didn't give in to Satan. They didn't give in to sin. They overcame. They're going to be priests of God and of Christ and will reign with him forever. Because of the resurrection, that's where we're going. And to close in Revelation 22, verses 1 through 5, then the angel showed me the river of the water of life as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb down the middle of the great street of the city. On each side of the river stood the tree of life, bearing 12 crops of fruit, yielding its fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations. No longer will there be any curse. The throne of God and of the Lamb will be in the city, and his servants will serve him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. There will be no more night. There will be no need for the light of a lamp or the light of the sun. For the Lord God will give them light, and they will reign forever and ever. The angel said to me, these words are trustworthy and true. The Lord God of the spirits of the prophets sent his angel to show his servants the things that must soon take place. He tries just to give us a vision, an image of where God wants us to be with him forever and ever, in a place that we can't even begin to imagine. And the only reason that we can go there, the only reason that we have an opportunity to do that, is because of Jesus died and he raised from the dead. God, thank you so much for the opportunity to study the scriptures today. God, thank you for the power that you reveal to us through the scriptures. God, thank you that the grave is empty. The tomb is empty. He's risen. He's not there. And God, I pray that we can see things differently. Help us see Jesus differently. Help us to live differently. Help us to go to the place that you want us to go, God, because of what you've done for us. We love you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Awesome. Awesome.